Welcome to church. This morning is a family service. We'll be starting the service off with some worship and baptisms, and we'd love it if you joined us in celebrating their choice to take the next step in their walk with Jesus. We're also continuing our sermon series that focuses on Philippians. Pastor Barry will be going through Philippians 2, 12 to 13 with his message titled, The Unsolved Mystery of Becoming Like Jesus. If you're new here, we love to get you connected with our community. You can message us on Facebook, Instagram, or by simply texting hello to 587-323-1199, and we'll respond right back. We are so glad you could join us today.
I was in a conversation recently with a friend of mine who admitted that they were obsessed with unsolved murder mysteries. I'm thinking that she's probably not the only one here. It wasn't that long ago that that mystery rooms and escape rooms were such a fad that it actually became a business genre. If you were to raise your hand, how many of us love watching or reading about mystery? Yeah, a whole bunch of us. One survey I read said that 84% of people rank mystery thrillers as their favorite movie genre. And another one said that mystery thriller and crime were the most read books of that particular year. I think it's fascinating to us. Maybe it's our intrigue of the unknown. Maybe it's like a puzzle. The challenge of putting the pieces together to figure out who done it before the author reveals it. You can go to almost every streaming provider and flip through the endless shows about mystery. But have you noticed what they've been doing the last number of years? Watch any series on TV, and when it comes, when it feels like they are about to resolve a conflict or reveal a particular part of the mystery, the credits come up. The show's over. Like, you, have you felt how frustrating that is? I don't know how many times I've caught myself watching the next episode just because I can't handle the tension and the curiosity. I think it's the same kind of delight that we experience in that game that I love to play with my granddaughter, Sophia. I like to hide my face behind my hands, surprise look on the face and put it back. And oh, she looks and she stares intently every time. Every time it's like a brand new experience. And then when you pull your hands away, it's just, she giggles and she laughs, just utterly delighted in the fun of this. She knows that I'm there behind my hands all the time, but she just looks forward to the mystery and to the suspense and then the revelation. What is it about this conceal and then reveal that we just love so much? What is it about how God has wired us that we are fascinated by these things and things that we don't understand? You know, my favorite genre includes crime and espionage, but even more than those, I am intrigued by the unknowns of faith and spirituality. Our text today from the book of Philippians that we are studying this year describes an unsolved mystery about the Christian faith that has been around since Jesus walked this earth. Many of us know our own brokenness. We know our own limitations. We know these things so well that we long to be the people that the Holy Spirit talks about in the Bible. We long to be like Jesus Christ. He is the most tangible picture of us humans that we have of who God is. And many times Scripture calls us to be like Jesus. The theological word for this is sanctification. It's a big word that simply means the process of us becoming like Jesus Christ. So the mystery that I'm referring to is how sanctification happens and who makes it happen. This mystery is the tension between the power of God and the responsibility we believers, people who follow Jesus Christ, have in the sanctification process. Is the Christian life a matter of passive trust in God or active obedience to God? Does it all depend upon God? Does it all depend upon us? Where is the balance between God's part and our part? How are we transformed from our old selfish ways to a new person in Christ that the Bible talks about? And when we see someone, and perhaps you know the two that were baptized here, when we see someone whose life really has been changed by Jesus Christ, well, how does that happen? It's partly what baptism signifies, that my life now is about Jesus Christ, and that transformation has already begun. Now, on the other hand, perhaps you've wondered how this transformation is ever going to happen for you. Perhaps you have hurts that you can't seem to get beyond. Perhaps there's emptiness deep inside that just doesn't seem to go away. Maybe it's nasty habits that keep making a mess of your relationship, and you just feel hopeless. Well, let's explore our text to see what clues the Apostle Paul gives us. Philippians chapter 2, verse 12. Kids, in your packet, there's your own sermon notes. They kind of look like this. You can pull those out, and you can follow along here with us as well. Little parentheses here. For those of you who noticed that we're actually skipping Philippians chapter 2, 1 to 11, that's true. But we're going to circle back around in December as a lead up to Christmas. Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 and 13. Follow along as I read. Therefore, dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you to will and to act according to his good purpose. For those of us who don't know what that bigger word in there is, that word salvation, and what it means, I just encourage you to kind of stick with us while we talk about this for a minute. Salvation has to do with being saved or protected from harm, from risk, from loss or destruction. The Greek word for salvation in this particular verse means to be saved from the consequences of our sin, which includes spiritual death and separation, eternal separation from God. If we are a forward-thinking person, this is something that we need to take seriously, it's important for us to consider. If we haven't thought about these things before, then I would encourage you to consider the truth and the reality of our sin, including that, whether you believe it or not, life after this physical life does exist. Scripture teaches that whenever we miss God's mark or we miss his standards, which is what sin literally means, the consequence of that failure is spiritual death and eternal separation from God. And in the laws of the spiritual realm, the consequence of this sin is death. It's what has brought physical death into this life, into our existence, and it's also brought spiritual death and separation from God. God's standard is his design. It's the way that we're meant to live and flourish. You know, perhaps you have heard of Adam and Eve, the first two people who God created, and how they disobeyed God by eating of the fruit of the tree of good and evil in the Garden of Eden. You can read that in Genesis 3 for yourself on your own later today if you wish. This is what happened to them. Their disobedience was sin, and the consequence of that sin introduced physical death and a bunch of other things, evil and suffering, pain and brokenness, sickness and disease. All that falls short of the standard of God's holiness, the standard of God's beauty and his glory, which includes a separation from God that would last all eternity, long after this life that we are in is over. And because we are descendants of Adam and Eve, we have all sinned. We all fall short of God's glory. Perhaps some of us are not as aware of our brokenness as others may be, but it makes no difference to the reality that each of us sin in some way. And so the penalty of sin is resting on each one of us. Like a guilty verdict in court, there's nothing we can do to escape these consequences. But God knew this. That's why Jesus came to be one of us, to suffer for the pain and the suffering that we face, and to die on a cross to pay the penalty of our sin on our behalf. And when we come to God acknowledging that we have sinned, that's called confession, and we choose to turn our heart from that sin, that's called repentance, and trust Jesus' death, that his death paid the penalty of our sin, we will be pardoned. We will be forgiven of our sin. Jesus pays the consequence for us of our death that we deserve. And we get to go free. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, "For God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the sin offering, to be the offering for our sin, so that we could be made right with God through Christ." So when Paul mentions salvation here in our text, that's what he's talking about. Salvation then starts a transformation with us from the person that we were to a person that better reflects the character and love of Jesus Christ. Again, that word is sanctification. That's what that means. Scripture calls this being in Christ. It means we become a part of God's family, and the Holy Spirit comes and lives inside of us. Now, at first glance, could you put verses 12 and 13 up again? It looks like Paul is saying he's instructing us to work for our salvation. Well, is that something that we can even do? The first thing we need to understand is that becoming like Jesus Christ involves trusting God's part. What is God's part? Well, God is the one who actually does the saving. He's our rescuer. He's the one that has taken the initiative to save us even before we realized we needed it. Romans 5:8 was already quoted this morning. But God showed his great love for us by sending Jesus Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. We had no clue we even needed him. If you read Genesis 3, when Adam and Eve first sinned, God looked forward to the billions of people that would eventually be born from them. And he included a plan to deal with the sin problem. It was God's idea. It was his initiative. It had nothing to do with what we've done, has nothing to do with what we haven't done. Perhaps you've heard us say this before. There is nothing that you can do to make God love you more. And there is nothing that you can do to make God love you less. This was his decision long before you were even born. Isn't that incredible? being given an opportunity to deal with the consequence of our sin and the results of our sin in our life is an incredible gift given freely by God. That's God's part. And I love how Paul describes this to the church in Ephesus in Ephesians chapter 2. He says, God saved you by his grace when you believed. And you can't take credit for this. This is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things that we have done so that none of us can boast about it. Trusting God's part means that we will simply receive this gift of salvation, his forgiveness of our sins. And when we do, he cancels the penalty. He sees us just as though we never sinned, and he makes us to be a new person. Salvation from our sin completely depends on God. There is nothing we can do to earn it, this free gift. There's no amount of effort. There's no amount of right living. There's no amount of trying to be the right person or be a good person. If this is what you're trying to do, you might as well give up now. It's not going to work. It cannot work. Salvation depends on God and his work. All we can do is trust him. All we can do is take him at his word that he will fulfill what he has said. This is where faith comes in. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. Faith is the confidence that what we hope for will actually happen. It gives us assurance about the things that we cannot see. Now, this isn't everyone's experience, but many people, when they choose to trust Jesus and his work on the cross, they sense something happen inside. They sense this change. They often say, I feel different. But whether we actually feel something different or not when we surrender our life to Christ, it isn't the indicator that God did or didn't do something. Either way, faith means that we trust God will do what he says he has already done. How God saves us, if I'm honest with you, and makes us a new person, this is a mystery in itself. We often can't put these things into words, but that he saves us, that he does the work of salvation, that's no mystery. It's all God. It's none of us. But then you might be wondering, well, if it's all God and it's none of us, well, then there's no mystery. Why are we even talking about this today? Well, the problem comes when Paul says in verse 12, here it is again, therefore, dear brothers, dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. If it all depends upon God, then why would Paul give this instruction about obedience and where we are to work out our salvation with fear and trembling? Does this not sound like we have to start working for our salvation? Sure can. But that's not what Paul is getting at. You see, becoming like Jesus Christ involves, first of all, trusting God's part while living our part. The New Living Translation makes what Paul means here clearer. It says this, work hard to show the results of your salvation, obeying God with deep reverence and fear. Paul is not suggesting that these Philippians attain their salvation just by trying harder. Or if they were just better, work harder. He is instructing them to live out the inner transformation that God is already doing because of his gracious gift to them. And as it's true for the Philippians, it's true for us. We have a responsibility to live out the change that God is doing inside of us. If we stay on the side of the spectrum that says, God does everything, and we do nothing, that only leads us to thinking that once we've said a prayer of salvation, then we can go live like hell. What we do with God's free gift of salvation is a big deal. It matters. So Paul says, you can't do that. You can't just say a prayer and then go live how you want to. Part of our salvation is acknowledging that Jesus is acknowledging and confessing that Jesus Christ is Lord. It's proclaiming that he not only has the right and the authority to be Lord and leader, but that we are surrendering to him and submitting to him as our Lord, as our leader. You see, it's one thing for us to say, oh yeah, I'm a Christian, but then we do nothing about our temper. Repeatedly just letting it blow off to the people around us. We can say, oh, I'm a Christian, but then we don't connect into church community thinking that we don't really need accountability. We don't really need that encouragement. You know, it's one thing to say, oh, yeah, I'm a Christian, but then we go and express ourselves sexually however our desires dictate. Or we treat our employees in whatever ways serve the bottom line. Or we treat our bosses with dishonor and disrespect. It's one thing to say, oh, I'm a Christian, but then we continue to put our needs and our wants above those who are closest to us, the people around us. Or we don't work to rein in our pride or our arrogance or our fear or our manipulation. Or we say we're a Christian, but then we just go ahead and spend our money and our own needs and wants with no consideration that we are stewards of God's money. Everything we have is his. You know, to live in these ways is not congruent with the gracious gift of salvation that we have been given. Verse 12 again, work hard to show the results of your salvation, obeying God with deep reverence and fear. Now, part of showing the results is that we willingly obey the instructions. We willingly obey the guidelines and the principles that God lays out in the Bible. Our fiercely independent and self-reliant culture does not like this. Doesn't like the words obey and submit. It rails against these concepts. Many years ago, when we were planting a church here in Edmonton, I remember a conversation with a young woman after I'd preached on the Great Commission in Matthew chapter 28. And in case you don't know, here's what Jesus taught. Let me just highlight verse 20 there. Jesus says, teach these new disciples to obey all the commands that I have given you. This young woman wanted me, what she wanted me to do was to change the words obey and commands. She didn't like them. She wasn't sure that that's what Jesus really meant. She thought they were more suggestions. They were good ideas that we could follow if we would choose. Whether we like it or not, faith in Christ is ultimately expressed through faith, through our obedience to Christ. Faith in Christ is ultimately expressed as obedience to Christ. And our obedience, though, is not out of fear, because we're afraid of the backhand of God if we screw up, if we make a mistake, step out of line. It's not that kind of fear. It's about a reverent respect and submission to Almighty God of the universe, who has ultimate power, ultimate authority. You know, the enemy and the values of this world will seek to convince us that we should be on the throne of our lives, that our needs are most important. Our attitudes can be expressed however we blame well want to. But Jesus goes even farther when he says, if you love me, you will obey me. If you love me. So we don't obey God with deep reverence in fear in order to earn some brownie points from God, try to get on God's good side because we're about to do something bad. We choose to obey God out of a heart of gratitude, a heart of love in response to the love that he extends to us. So becoming like Jesus Christ involves trusting God's part while living our part. 2 Corinthians 13, verse 5 says this: examine yourselves to see if your faith is genuine. If I'm not taking this call to obey seriously, is my faith really genuine? Perhaps for some of us, it's even including in this obedient, this call to walk in obedience to Jesus Christ in baptism. If we haven't taken these things seriously, is my faith really genuine? I think another good question to ask ourselves is, why am I obeying God? Is it because I'm scared of him? Is it because I view it as some list of rules of do's and don'ts, and that's what keeps life safe and comfortable for me? Or is it because I am drawing close to him in an intimate love relationship? And so I obey because I love him and am grateful for his love and his presence in my life. Okay, let's do a recap. Salvation is all up to God. That's God's part. Living out his gracious gift of salvation is up to us. That's our part. But what about the times that I lack any desire to honor God? Or when it feels like God's instructions are only rules that just steal the joy of life? What about those times when I can try really hard to do what's right and to honor God, and yet I still seem to mess up? I do the exact opposite. I say something nasty. I still react so rudely. I still go ahead and do what I just wanted to do in the first place. Growing up on a farm, I've been driving vehicles since I was about 7 years old, if you can believe that. Not sure what my dad was thinking. I can still remember the first time driving that old International, that old white, kind of cream-colored International 5-speed pickup in the open field where it was safe and I wouldn't hit anything. But sometime early into my teenage years, I developed this need for speed. Couldn't tell you where it came from, but it was an overwhelming desire. Driving the speed limit for me was unbelievably irritating and impatient. I would get angry with slow drivers in front of me. Well, this carries on into my 30s. There are a number of times I remember God speaking to me, convicting me of my speeding. And so I would try harder not to speed and to keep the speed limit. And it would drive me crazy. My hands would be white-knuckled, gripping the steering wheel. I thought to myself, I'm going to die. Like, who can actually do this? Well, what I didn't realize is that almost every other driver can drive the speed limit and they're okay. But not me. Not me. Obeying this conviction would typically last a couple days when the Holy Spirit would talk to me, maybe a week. But then I was off again flying down the road. Sometimes I just gave up. I said, I don't care. I don't even want to change. So what do? When we don't even have a desire to live out this gracious gift of salvation, even when it's just in an area of speeding. Well, here's the cool part of what I never really saw in this text until I was studying it a couple weeks ago. Look at this. It's God who enables us. It's God who enables us. Verse 13, for it is God who works in you to will and to act. And if you read carefully, God is helping us to be willing. He's helping us to be determined and to act. Let me read this verse from the New Living Translation. For God is working in you, giving you the desire and the power. What's so refreshing about this is that it's just not up to us in our own strength, our own devices, our own white knuckling through life. No, I'm not going to get angry again. It's God who gives us the desire. It's God through the Holy Spirit who enables us to do what we can't do. We've never been meant to do it in our own strength. We can't do it in our own strength. So if you're like me, have a lead foot, or you can't get your gossip under your control, or you're stealing, or maybe lying or laziness, or your fear, perhaps your negative thoughts, or your sexual desires, and you don't even really want to change some of these things, we can go to God, asking Him to motivate us, to empower us to bring this particular area under the leadership of Him. Do you do that? Are you asking Him? You know, for me, I knew deep inside that my speeding was wrong. And it wasn't just the cost of the tickets. But the more that I would disregard the Holy Spirit's conviction, the guiltier I would feel. And the harder I would try next time. But each time just ended up like the last. I was getting so frustrated. I'd play different mental games to make the speed limit okay. I would do self-talk. I tried to pray more. Nothing seemed to work. I'm so frustrated. God was using this conviction to create within me the desire and the determination to deal with this, even though it got more uncomfortable before it got better. It got worse before it got better. You see, when we are working on our obedience, God is working in us, motivating us, challenging us, reminding us. He's giving us the desire and the power to do what pleases Him. Verse 13 again. For God is working in you, giving you the desire and the power to do what pleases Him. Now, on the surface, it can appear that God is just self-absorbed. All He wants is just to feel good. But that's not the case at all. The Westminster Catechism says it well. The chief end of man, the chief end of man or people, is to glorify God and to enjoy Him forever. The cool part about this is that there is no evil, there is no ill intent with God. God is love. God is light. And there is no darkness in Him. And so what pleases Him is all that is right, all that is perfect, all that is beautiful, all that is holy and righteous. And when we, through the Holy Spirit, when He, through the Holy Spirit, works in us, giving us the desire and the power to do what pleases Him, whatever that is, it's what's best for us and for our witness to the world around us as to who God is, because we better reflect who He is to the people around us. God's desire is that us individually and us corporately, whether it's in a large group like this or whether it's in our small group, that we, as the church, we represent Him well. We are His physical body here on this earth. So as God and I are working on this issue of speeding kind of on one track, God is working on a parallel track as well. addressing brokenness of pain and emptiness in my life and in my heart. I was involved in a ministry of inner healing that used to be called Life Path. I was both on team ministering to others, and sometimes I was in the chair being ministered to. And on this one particular evening, I'm in the chair being ministered to, and I can't even remember what the issue was that we were going through, but I experienced some profound healing and freedom that night. And as I'm walking to my vehicle, I can remember feeling lighter, feeling freer than I had probably ever had before. I feel excited and extremely grateful for what God was doing in my life. I get into my vehicle and I pull onto 34th Avenue, heading east from 119th Street. And I immediately get the feeling that I'm driving way over the speed limit. So feeling bad, I look down. I wasn't even going the speed limit. And I was totally content. How did that happen? That's a miracle. Yeah. In my obedience to deal with the hurts and the bondage in my own heart, God was taking care of my need for speed. And as a root in my life, he took it away that night. I don't even know how it connected with whatever the hurt that we were dealing with that night, but he also dealt with this need for speed. Now, I've struggled on and off with my speed since then. I'm not perfect at it. But that root need, it's gone in my life. Praise God. Being respectful and courteous when driving pleases God. And it's part of God's work in helping me become like Jesus Christ. So let me ask you, was it all God that did the work in me and I had nothing to do with it? I think the answer is no. I had to work at this. I had to seek his help in this. But was it all me and only my self-effort? Well, no, I think the answer is no. God was clearly at work in this and working on this particular issue in my life that did not honor him. So where's the line between God's part and our part? Honestly, I have no clue. I honestly do not know. To me, it remains a mystery, an unsolved mystery. Paul makes it clear that becoming like Christ involves both God's part, his sovereignty, his foreknowledge, his initiative, his power, and our part, our human responsibility, our choice to draw near to him, to obey, to trust. And Paul actually makes no effort to rationally harmonize the two. So how do I personally live with this unsolved mystery? Well, there is a phrase that I have found helpful, not perfect, but helpful. And it goes like this. Pray and trust like it depends upon God. Live and work like it depends on me. What I've realized is that I can't control God or God's part in this. I have no say in what he does or what he doesn't do. I can only control what I can control. And even then, at times, I can't even control that very well. To me, embracing both sides of this mystery helps me to trust God 100% that he is sovereign and that he's got this covered from start to finish. While at the same time, I give my 100% to love and to serve and to live out this gracious gift of salvation that he has given me. And then I trust God's faithfulness when I fail to do my part. Because I will and I do. I say, let's walk in this mystery of relating to and loving an invisible God. Will you join me in it? Here's a prayer as a response today. Not sure what God's doing in your own heart, but here's a prayer that I invite you to pray with me in committing ourselves to this mystery. Please read this prayer through, and then all of us who are willing, there's no pressure for you to do this. All of us who are willing, we'll read this together out loud. Take just a minute and read through this prayer. We good? Why don't we stand? And again, if you are willing, no pressure to do this. I am not asking you to do something against your will. But if you are willing, then let's read this out loud together. Here we go. Father God, I come to you in Jesus' name. I acknowledge that I don't fully understand the mystery of your sovereignty and my personal responsibility in the process of becoming like Christ. But I choose now, by an act of my will, to trust you and the work that you are doing in my life. While, same time, I commit to loving, serving, and obeying you in my life and relationships. I want my life to glorify you. Please give me the desire, the determination, and the power to please you. Fill me with the Holy Spirit. May I sense his presence and depend on his power. Thank you. Well, I'd like to bless you today as we bring our service to a close. But just a couple things before I do. On your way out, before you leave today, I would encourage you, meet someone that you haven't met before. And if you want to join us for some fellowship downstairs, man, there's like tables of free bread that you can and a bunch of other food you can take with us. Just spend some time with us. We'd love to help get you connected and get to know you. And if you want prayer for anything at all, anything, we have a team that loves to pray for people. Like this is their gift, like this is their passion. Come over to this side of the stage and they would love to pray for you, whatever that is. Well, it's becoming a habit around here that we want to bless each other. And so I'd like to bless you today from the book of Hebrews. And so we often, one of the ways to do this is we hold our hands out like this. And it's just simply a way of saying, God, I want your blessing. I want everything that you want, that you have for me. I receive this. It comes from Hebrews chapter 13, verse 20. Here it is. May the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, may he equip you with everything good for doing his will. And may he work in you what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. And all who want this in their life say, amen. Amen. Bless you. Have a great week.
Thanks for joining us. If you need anything, don't hesitate to contact us. You can find more information on our website, Facebook, or on YouTube and Instagram. We'll see you again soon.